Hello everyone, welcome to my channel PS Eduwald. In this video, I will be explaining the structural and functional unit of life known as the cell. Anyone interested in learning about cell can watch this video. So let's get started. Cells are often compared to bricks. You have noticed that bricks are assembled to make a building. Bricks are assembled to construct rooms, to construct floors, and finally a building is being constructed. In a similar fashion, cells are assembled to make the body of every organism. In the picture, you can see the similarity between a brick wall and an onion peel. Both bricks in a building and cells in a living organisms are basic structural units. Cells in the living organisms are complex living structures, unlike non-living bricks. So what is the definition of a cell? Cell is the fundamental structural and functional unit of all living organisms. It is the smallest unit of life and is often called the building block of life. Why it is called the building block of life? Let me give you an example. If we consider the human body, we will notice that the human body is made up of various organs like heart, kidney, brain, hand, legs, etc. These organs are made up of tissues. These tissues are made up of billions and trillions of cells. Similarly, plants are also made up of cells. And as I have mentioned before, how a building is being constructed, the same way cells are assembled to make the body of every organism. So cells are the building blocks of life and the fundamental unit of all living organisms. Remember this. A single cell is capable of independent existence. A cell carries out nutrition, respiration, excretion, transportation, reproduction, all life processes. Every cell has its own life. All organisms start life as a single cell. We human beings too start our life as a single cell. Old and weak cells are continuously replaced by new cells. And remember that unicellular organisms, they are also capable of independent existence, since every cell has its own life. The egg of a hen is the best example of a cell which can be seen with naked eye. Remember this. Now coming to the discovery of the cell. Invention of the microscope led to the discovery of the cell. Here you need to remember few years. In the 1590s, Hans and Zacharias Janssen developed the compound microscope. Then in the year 1665, Robert Hooke, he was a scientist, he improved the design of this existing compound microscope. And with this improved microscope, he discovered or he observed the cell for the first time. He discovered cell for the very first time. He took thin slices of cork and observed them under a microscope. What is a cork? Cork is a part of the bark of a tree. He noticed partitioned boxes or tiny compartments in cork slice. And these boxes appeared like a honeycomb. And he also noticed that one box was separated from the other by a wall. He coined the term cell for each box because these reminded him of the cells in a monastery. Cells are small rooms. So these boxes reminded him of the small rooms in a monastery, and hence he coined the term cell. Robert Hooke actually observed dead cells. Okay, he didn't observe living cell. So if you are asked to write who was the first person who discovered cell, it was, you have to write Robert Hooke. Now, what is cytology? The branch of biology which deals with study of cell is known as cytology. Robert Hooke is known as father of cytology. The first living cell was discovered by Antony van Leeuwenhoek in the year 1674. This is very important. Robert Hooke discovered dead cell, but the first living cell was discovered by Anton van Leeuwenhoek. From he discovered a living cell in pond water. He was a master microscope maker. He was a master in microscopy. So he developed a microscope, and using that he observed living cell for the very first time. So if question comes that who discovered cell, you have to write Robert Hooke. Who discovered first living cell, you have to write Antony van Leeuwenhoek. Remember this. And then there is another type of microscope which is used extensively nowadays. It is known as the electron microscope. It was first developed by Ernst Ruska and Max Noll. And also remember this, that Robert Brown discovered the nucleus. Cell theory. Originally, the cell theory was given by two scientists, Matthias Schleiden and Theodor Schwann. In the year 1838, Matthias Schleiden, who was a botanist, he said that all plant parts are made up of cells. 1 year later, Theodor Schwann, who was a zoologist, he said that all animal tissues are made up of cells. Before this, nobody like Robert Hooke or Anton van Leeuwenhoek, nobody had mentioned about this thing that all plant or animal bodies are made up of cells. They just discovered cells or observed cells. They didn't mention anything like this. So these two scientists, they first said that all organisms are made up of cells, and cell is the basic unit of living things. Later on, one more point was added, which was given by Rudolf Virchow. He said that all cells arise from pre-existing cells. For example, in bacteria, two cells are formed from one cell by the process of cell division. And like I have mentioned before, that we also start, we human beings start our life as a single cell. Have you ever wondered how this single cell finally gets transformed into a complex body? This is due to increase in the number of cells. So, all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Hence, the modern cell theory proposed by Schleiden, Schwann and Rudolf Virchow states that all living organisms are composed of one or more cells. Cell is the basic unit of structure and organization in organisms. All cells arise from pre-existing cells. And note that viruses are an exception to the cell theory. Remember this. Organisms show variety in cell number. There are millions of living organisms. They are of different shapes and sizes. Their organs also vary in shape, size, and number of cells. So, on the basis of cell number, organisms are categorized into two groups. One, unicellular organisms. To multicellular organisms. So, what are unicellular organisms? Organisms that are made up of only a single cell are called unicellular organisms. For example, amoeba, paramecium, euglena, these are all single cell or unicellular organisms. As I have mentioned before, that a cell is capable of independent existence and can carry out all the functions which are necessary for a living being. So a single cell organism like amoeba captures and digests food, respires, excretes, grows and reproduces. So all the necessary functions are carried out by a single cell. Multicellular organisms. What are multicellular organisms? Organisms made of more than one cell are called multicellular organisms. All organisms that we see around us with our naked eye are multicellular organisms. Some common examples are human beings, trees, insects, birds, etc. We all know that living things grow. A plant will get taller and produce new leaves and flowers. A child grows into an adult. So in multicellular organisms, this growth happens due to increase in cell number. The bigger the animal or the plant, more will be the cell number. Organisms show variety in shape of cells. Cells may be round, elongated, biconcave, spindle-shaped. Some cells are branched like the nerve cell. Shape of cells may be variable or fixed. For example, amoeba has no definite shape. It keeps on changing its shape. In the picture below, on your left, you can see the picture of amoeba. The change in shape is due to formation of pseudopodia or false feet, which facilitates movement and help in capturing food. Like amoeba, white blood cells in human blood can change their shape. There is a membrane that surrounds every living cell. This membrane is known as cell membrane. The shape of any cell is provided by its cell membrane. And in amoeba and white blood cells, the cell membrane is highly flexible. Cells of plants, bacteria, fungi have an additional protective layer outside their cell membrane known as the cell wall. This cell wall provides shape to the organism. To your right, you can see the picture of a plant cell. I have said that plants, bacteria and fungi have additional cell wall, and in animal cell only cell membrane is present. So this cell wall or the cell membrane provides shape to the organism. The shape of a cell depends on the job it performs. For example, the human red blood cells are biconcave and disc-shaped. They are the smallest cells in the body. They have a lifespan of 120 days. And during this 4-month lifespan, they need to squeeze through tiny capillaries to deliver oxygen to the entire body. That is why mature RBCs do not have nucleus, so that they can make room for more oxygen. They carry oxygen from the lungs to the body and carbon dioxide from the body back to the lungs. That is why they are disc-shaped and they are the smallest cells, and that is why they do not contain nucleus. Now coming to the nerve cell. Nerve cells are elongated and branched. Why they are elongated and branched? They receive and transfer messages, thereby helping to control and coordinate the working of different parts of the body. That is why they are branched and elongated. muscle cells. In the picture, you can see that the muscle cells are spindle-shaped and thin. These features help them to contract and relax. Skin cells. Skin cells are flat. Why they are flat? They are protective cover of the body. The flat shape helps them to cover a large area. Okay. Human white blood cell or WBC. Like amoeba, WBCs are irregular in shape and can squeeze through capillary walls. WBC changes their shape to destroy germs. In the picture, you can see how the pseudopodia of WBC is engulfing bacteria and it is getting destroyed. Guard cells in plant. In plants, guard cells of stomatal pore in leaves are bean-shaped or crescent-shaped. Why? Because they play an important role in regulating the opening and closing of pores. Variety in size of cell. Cell size is variable. The size of cells in living organisms may be as small as a millionth of a meter or may be as large as a few centimeters. However, most of the cells are microscopic in size and are not visible to the naked eye. They need to be enlarged by a microscope. Smallest cell of size 0.1 micron is Mycoplasma or PPLO. And what is the full form of PPLO? Pleuropneumonia like organisms. Remember this, they are the smallest cells of size 0.1 micron. The egg of a hen, as I have told you before, is a single cell which we can observe with our naked eye. The yellow part of the egg is the yolk. It is the part of the single cell. You can observe this single cell without any magnifying device. The longest cell in human body is nerve cell. It is of 90 micrometer. The smallest cell in human body is red blood cell, which is of 7 micrometer. I have told this before. And remember that mature red blood cells do not contain nucleus. The largest cell measuring about 170 millimeter into 130 millimeter is the egg of an ostrich. And the largest unicellular plant cell is Acetabularia. You can see the picture of ostrich egg and to your right you can see the picture of Acetabularia. Now coming to the most important question, do bigger animals have larger cells? Are the cells in an elephant larger than the cells in a rat? Your answer should be no. The size of the cells has no relation with the size of the body of the animal or plant. It is not necessary that the cells of an elephant be much bigger than those in a rat. The size of the cell is related to its function. For example, nerve cells in both elephant and rat are long and branched. They perform the same function that of transferring messages. Bigger animals have more number of cells. Remember this. So, the size of the cell has no relation with the organism in which it is present. This is very, very important. You should remember this. Here I conclude part 1 of the lecture. Here are some important questions related to this lecture. Define a cell. A cell is capable of independent existence. Explain. Who coined the term cell? what is cytology, who discovered living cell and in which year, what is the cell theory, who proposed the cell theory, name two unicellular and two multicellular organisms, why are muscle cells spindle shaped, name the smallest living cell and the largest animal cell. Hope you like the video. I'll soon be uploading the part 2 of this lecture. So stay tuned and have a nice day. Bye.